This is Business and Economy Network.
Hello viewers, it's glad to know you are watching our program. Those of you watching us in far away, Abuja, Port Harcourt, Ilorin, Kano, Kaduna, I want to say thank you so very much. Those of you who are watching us outside the shores of Nigeria, you are watching Business and Economy Network. My name is Peter Nwoche. On behalf of the production crew, I want to say thank you so very much for all your mails, inquiries. Well, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, we are looking at agriculture in Nigeria, which the federal government says is going to be the mainstay for Nigerian economy. And looking at agriculture, recently some state governments have started doing some initiative. Recently, the Oyo state government launched the Agro Oyo. And some other state governments are also following suit. And we are looking forward to seeing great and wonderful things happening in the agricultural sector in Nigeria. For the program rundown today, we have unique agricultural firms doing very well, and we have them up. For special spotlight today, we have the CEO of Saltree International. And not left out of special agricultural report, we have Jubilee Agrotech Limited, the company doing very well in Faraway Kano. And not left out for company in focus, today we are looking at Prime Gold Fertilizers Company and Chemical, doing very well in Port Harcourt, Ilorin, Lagos, and also in Sokoto. It's going to be an interesting watch. I'll be back after this timeout. Agriculture, mainstay for the Nigerian economy.
To get insights, views, and critics on key players and various sectors of the Nigerian economy, watch Business and Economy Network. Saltree International Company Limited. In 2007, when cassava was launched as an industrial crop in Nigeria, the founder of Saltree International Company Limited gave a presentation on cassava, and that caught the interest of investors, especially foreign investors, to the possibility that can be reached when local farmers invest in cassava production. Foreign investors were able to pump funds into the industry to enable the influx of cassava varieties for local industrial production. Those cassava crops varieties could have disease resistance and give farmers better yield.
That was a project of 2007. That was about the time cassava was actually being launched as an industrial crop. That was also about the time IITA was trying to get the international communities, the international donors, to start putting money into cassava as a crop. I had the opportunity to speak at one of the very first conference on cassava, and that was where I presented that presentation on unleashing the power of cassava in Africa, and that actually opened the donors' eyes to funding cassava production. This time, not production; it was the variety. The variety we had as at that time were the old varieties that were giving us very poor yield. So we needed to push them to pump money into IITA to provide new varieties, the TME varieties that are disease resistant and that can give us better yield. So at that time we needed to talk about it, to promote it, to let them to get their buy-in, you know. And I think it has worked, because right now we have fantastic variety from IITA, and IITA has really done very well in the aspect of promoting good varieties of cassava into the society. Although those researches were done, and we also needed to now push it a step further to say, how do we move these varieties to the farmers? They can't afford to buy at the rate IITA is buying. So we now start canvassing for donors to also provide funding to distribute some of this them free, so that farmers can start multiplying and start reproducing. And I thank God it's a success. It's today we have a lot of these varieties out there. And that's as a result of some of the job that we're doing far back at Baba Obasanjo's time, when we were pushing cassava as an industrial crop.
There's a lot of research going on that will enable farmers to work less and achieve more. Now, there are various cassava disease-free crop varieties. The use of these varieties will help farmers to understand how these varieties grow. Poor farmers are encouraged to go for crop varieties that will survive under harsh soil conditions.
IIT has done a whole lot, I'll give that to them, have done a whole lot of research, and they have released very wonderful, fantastic varieties. We have the TME, leading the list is TME 419. That's a very, very top variety. That's very high starch content. The very first was TMS 3752. That was the first original disease resistant variety. That I will say you must have on your farm any day, anytime. Even though the starch is not as high as the other TME, we still see it as more rugged. The farmers don't need to weed too much because it has canopies. Why the TME 419 has is it grows very straight and it does not have canopy, so farmers have to weed more. So I always say have the two on your field, because this gives you, sometimes if the soil is not very good, the TME will not do too well. You need to put fertilizer. But where you have a poor farmer, I would rather advise a poor farmer who cannot afford fertilizer and his soil is already going depleted to go for the TMS 3752, because that still survive. Even when the soil is not too good, the farmer will still get something really reasonable, and the starch is about 25%. The starch content of the TME can be as high as 27-30%. In the rainy season can be as high as 25, when the others are around 20. During the dry season it could go as high as 27-30%, when the others are just around 25. So for us in the starch industry, we prefer the high starch content varieties. And that's what we are promoting now, to encourage the farmers to grow the high content and high starch content varieties so that they can also earn more. We actually even pay with starch content to give them some encouragement, you know. So the varieties are many, but the first and maybe the top, and you have so many in between. So many varieties in between.
Oyo State has a lot of potentials because of the availability of large landscape and a love for cassava plants. Already, experts see the state as a food basket of the nation, and the people are recipient, nice, and not hostile to agricultural goods. These and other reasons have made Pastry International Company Limited stay in the part of the country.
Oyo State, in the first place, is the food basket of Nigeria. Two, Oyo State have land, vast land. When you go to other states of west of the south, you may not have the kind of land. I mean, when you were coming, I'm sure you were just saying land. You wonder, why is all this land not green? So Oyo State have a lot of land. Then these parts of Oyo State are known for cassava cultivation. They love the crop. So when we were choosing a site, we were looking for a site where the people love the crop. So it's easy for you to just do some little work and you get them to increase their productivity. Unlike if you were bringing rice here, I mean, rice is strange to them here. They do tubers. It's either you are bringing yam their way or you are bringing cassava or maize. Those were their crops. So we chose here because we felt they love the crop. They also have land. Three, I also see the people as nice people. I think they are nice. They look warm to me. They look warm to me. Because since we've been here, I mean, this is like their factory. It's our factory. I don't ever see it as mine. No, it's our factory. The stakeholders are large. And the stakeholders start from the villagers. They see this place as theirs. So it's the people. If you go to another part of the country, the people are hostile. They could allow you, give you land today, and in 2 years time, the youth are at your gate asking you to come and pay new money and all of that. And all of that we never really had here. The people are really nice people, and they are nice. They are really kind people. So it's all those facilitated our comfort and our stay.
Information is very good, they said, but right information is very vital, especially to your business. Why not join us on Business and Economy Network, where you learn more about business information.
Jubilee Agrotech. Some Nigerian businesses are often seen going to China to bring other varieties of a given patent fertilizer product to Nigeria. These products are manufactured by other companies in China. This is deterrent to consumers in Nigeria who may patronize fake fertilizers products instead of buying from well-known companies.
No, yeah, now we start, like now we have, let me give an example. We have like 20 products. Maybe five of these products are under patent. Under patent, that's mean if I'm a company X, a company Y cannot go to China or to any place to bring these products because it's under patent for this special company. So I used to bring it, okay, and the patent, that's mean is a new product, is a new production. Okay, it used to be like 10 years patent, 12 years patent. Because let me tell you things, like some of these, some of the companies, when we bring a product patent to Nigeria, they used to go to China or to India or to, they used to imitate or to bring the same of this product from other manufacturer, any manufacturer, they used to bring it to Nigeria. The difference is very big. The difference is very big between the original, which is from Bayer, Monsanto, from the well-known companies, and the fake one, which is kind of bring it from any manufacturer. This is affecting the industry, yeah, of agriculture. Yeah.
Each crops in Nigeria have special mixtures, which means that there are various ways to take care of different crops growing on Nigerian soil. At the present time, partnership with Spanish companies has enabled Jubilee Agrotech introduce at least 12 new fertilizer solutions for various crops growing on Nigerian soil.
In fact, in Nigeria, most of the farmers, they know NPK, which is 15-15-15, and urea. This one is a big business, but at the same time, it's not enough. It's not enough, not only in terms of improving the agriculture in Nigeria, it's not enough, because in addition to NPK and urea, which all farmers they used to eat and they used to use it, now we start introducing something special. And there is, you know, for maize, you can't use only NPK and urea. For maize, there is special compound, okay? You can use it for maize. For sorghum, there is special also mixture. For cowpea, there is special mixture. Each crop has a special mixture. Let us take an example. Now we start introducing also one of the brands from Europe. It's called from SQM. SQM is one of the leader company in terms of fertilizer and NPKs in the world. Now we start like bringing potassium nitrate. There's something called potassium nitrate. Before, there's nothing called potassium nitrate in Nigeria. If you go everywhere, if you go to maybe in Kenya, to Uganda, most of the greenhouses you enter, you can sell a very huge quantity of potassium nitrate. Everybody know it, every farmer know it. Here, you imagine that now we start introducing the farmer since like 2 years, and the farmer, they saw the result, and they like it. They like it very well because the result is different. And if you want to compare NPK urea to potassium nitrate, I'm giving you a small example. We have many other products. You can go to like calcium nitrate. This is special fertilizers. You can go to NPK plus tracing elements also, micro and macro elements. And now with collaboration also with the Spanish company, it's called TradeCorp. We are going to bring also like, we can say like almost 12 new products to Nigeria for special crops. Yani for potato, there is one product. For tomato, there is one product. One fertilizer, I mean. For each crops has a fertilizer its own. You can use for this one. Like for banana, you have to bring maybe potassium, okay? But you cannot use only urea and NPK anyhow. No, you have to be specialized. That's what I told you before, that we are trying to enlighten the farmer how to use this product. Because this product, you know, now if somebody has 1 hectare, he want to plant maize. If you bring for him a special seed, hybrid seed, or a special seed, and a special fertilizer, and a special chemical, definitely the production will go from, you know, let me give you an example now, if you go to any farmer, the production in the hectare is about 2 ton, 3 ton per hectare. But you know, if you do a good job for the farmer and you give him the special products, you can go to 20 ton. And I know what I'm saying. You can go to from 10 to 20 ton.
Jubaili Agrotech has a solid stand in Nigeria with many branches and warehouses spread across the country. There are also technical experts who move around and make sure that chemicals which are brought are of high quality and the chemicals are used in the correct way. One problem for which local farmers still complain is that some of the crops they grow are not profitable at all. Jubaili Agrotech makes sure those farmers are given good facilities and good products as well as training to make them stay in business.
With them, as the branch manager mentioned, that we have many branches and we have warehouses all over the country. So we have one technical officer in charge of each warehouse. So this technical officer is moving around his area. He visited the villages and he visited the ADB offices, and we are collaborating with many associations like Sasakawa, like Ministry of Agric. So we can reach the farmer. We conduct like weekly training for them so they will be able to know and they will be more aware about using the chemical. Not only for using the chemical, even we are caring about protecting their health. You know, most of them, they don't care about using chemicals, you don't know how to handle it. Some of them, they use chemical without protective clothes, without nose mask, without gloves. So we are trying to show them the dangerousness of using chemical and how to protect your health. This one is more important for me than production.
What
you know, our farmers are smart. When you teach them and when you show them how to handle the chemical, especially if you do it practically in the field, next time he will be able to do it himself. Just show him in the field, practically, don't just give them lectures. After we lecture them, we go to the field and we conduct field days. So he will be able to see what we are doing exactly. So the next step, he will do everything himself. You know, always I live with the farmers and I feel their pains. They have many problems. You know, if you ask the farmer, what's your problem, he will complain. He complains of the prices of agric inputs, of fertilizer. He complains of the prices of agrochemical. He complains of the price of the crops. Some of the crops now is not profitable for the farmers, like tomato, like cotton. So we don't want our farmer to give up on these crops. What we have to do now, we have to supply the farmers with agric inputs in good prices, fertilizers. We have to give them more facilities. Even our yes, we have to reduce this problem of unemployment. Yes, by giving small loans for our yes, let them start cultivation, and we'll help them from our side. We can help the yes to start this project.
You are watching Business and Economy Network. What a reliable way of getting an incisive, informative information to help you in your business. Stay tuned.
Prime Gold Fertilizer. Sometimes it takes a negative challenge to move a corporate body to start producing or offering a service. For Prime Gold Fertilizer, it took the shortage of fertilizer on the company's farm for them to start producing it themselves. For many companies, lack of commodities or raw materials have made management to see such negative area as opportunity where the company can tap into and make profit.
Yeah, Prime Gold Fertilizer started as a result of acute such shortage of fertilizer for use in our own farm. I'm a farmer, a commercial farmer at that. I run large oil palm estates in Agbara in Ogun State, at Idoye village to be precise. And as a result of the coming of the Zimbabwean farmers, which my company Mid Ocean Shipping participated actively in the logistics handling of the coming into Nigeria, the importation of the equipment, handling, clearing process through customs in the ports, and being one of the first Nigerians to see what the Zimbabweans are doing. And going back 1 year after, seeing how they have transformed a rural setting into an interesting, enterprising agricultural landscape. And I took it as a challenge, and I approached the executive governor then of Kwara State, and expressed my interest in doing the same as the Zimbabwean farmers. And to their great mind, they didn't waste time to ask me, where are you from, what did you want to do? They only said, we don't grant land to speculators, and we want to see whether you're serious in agriculture. I say, I'm serious. You can visit the oil palm estate in Agbara, which they did. They sent delegates to the farm, saw what we're doing, the palms we've gotten from NIFO and doing well. And it did not take 1 month. They granted us 755 hectares in Ejindo Gari, in Moro local government.
Starting the fertilizer business was a big success, as government gave prime good trailers, lots of fertilizers to begin with. Other commodities were added, but in 2008, there was a serious loss of investment due to unavailability of fertilizer. Then the management of prime good had to overcome this challenge by setting up a boot camp, which became the knowledge base of fertilizer production.
And we started off well. That year, the state gave us the 3 trailer load subsidized fertilizer. We planted up maize and soya beans and the peanuts, groundnuts. The farm did well. 2008, there was shortage of fertilizer. The state could not supply in time. And we have planted hybrid soy, hybrid maize, and which cannot do well without fertilizer. And 430 hectares planted up seriously malfunctioned. There was no fertilizer. The growth was not encouraging. And we saw our investment perish. In fact, that year, we lost 58 million. So that sent us cracking our heads. What should be done? Why must it continue like this? I asked myself, what is the rocket science in this fertilizer that it must be imported from Ukraine or then Netherlands before you can get it? And why is it such a kind of mafia-like control in the ministries, shrouded with some political scheming? In federal level, then it was a contract, people who are pedal power, pedal influence, and they get the fertilizer. Everything was looking mysterious about it. I said, I questioned myself, how can it be done? And this should be done. That was how we started off. I didn't go for experts who are, we know the basics. We went back to chemistry. I started reading SS1 chemistry books. And some graduates, 2 engineers who were my wards, and they were very interested in what I want to do. They started teaching me basic chemistry, and we set up like a boot camp. I never took teaching from people until it became very obvious we know what we are doing. And there's one old man in Awuchi area, Pa Matthew. He's so experienced in fertilizer production, and they led me to him as a result of the suffering. And the old man really taught me the basics.
Welcome back, viewers. This is where time will permit us today. And I want to say thank you so very much for all our CEOs and all you who have called in and all you who have written concerning this program. Well, this is where time, and like I said, will actually permit. But send your emails, your inquiries, your comments, your criticism. We really appreciate it. Like I always said, don't be discouraged. The bunch of keys that you have, the last one might be the one that will unlock the door. Just like federal government is trying to unlock our economy to make sure that Nigerians live in prosperity, you have a role to play. Perseverance, determination will breed success. Well, I'm doing my own part, educating you and letting you know what is happening. What are you doing? Think of what you can do for this nation and know what all the time Nigeria will do for you. God bless you.